On today's video, we are going to dive into the epic world. That is right. We're going to talk about epic commanders and which ones I believe you should keep your eye on. Here's the deal. I cannot tell you what the best commanders, the top tier best commanders you can get, because each and every one of us has a different situation, play the game differently, have different luck. And so all these things factor into which commanders you should be focusing on. This video is all about epic commanders, which ones I want to point out to you guys to keep an eye on. This is for you to make the best decision based on your gameplay, your game style, your in-game situation, and many other things. This is all up to you. So let's start the video. Smash a like. And yeah, welcome to you. YouTube, welcome back to Gecko Gaming. That is right, we're no longer the Gecko. After yesterday's stream, I announced the rebrand. We're changing things up, and now welcome to Gecko Gaming. I am Gecko, and let's talk about epic commanders today. Here's the deal about epic commanders. Unlike legendary commanders, going after epic commanders one by one might not be necessarily the best play, and let me explain why. To get epic commander sculptures, you have so many avenues that it's very, very hard and complicated to time which one will get from where. A few examples I can give you are events that are civilization based, and so you can get the commanders as part of that event and that civilization. On top of that, in the expedition, you have the expedition shop, which has a weekly commander. You can get as many of his sculptures as you want every day. For 1,000, you can get him for as long as he's available. He's available for a few, I think it's 3 days, and then they swap between them. You can also get commander sculptures just like this. There are plenty of other ways to get epic commander sculptures. A big part of the epic commander sculptures you'll be getting come from the gold keys, which give drop a decent amount of epic commander sculptures. And so you can reach a very weird situation where you might want to focus only on, I don't know, Joan, but for some weird reason your luck worked out in a way that your Yulji got maxed first. And so the real question isn't which commander you should max out first, but rather which commanders you should keep your eye on. Now here's another quick catch that you should know about. There are the epic commander sculptures, the generic ones, are much less valuable than legendary commander sculptures. Not only because it's epic and legendary, but because maxing out all your epics won't take you too long. It'll take you a few months, but it's not like 6 months in you won't have all epic commanders maxed out and you can actually get it done. And so once that happens, all those epic generic commanders, which at some point in your city hall, you'll end up getting 5 of those every day. And on top of that, 100 for each seasonal event. You're going to get to a point where you're starting to pile these guys up at an alarming rate. At a very alarming rate, to the point where if we go look at my epics, which have been maxed for quite some time, I don't have anyone at that level of craziness of amounts of sculptures. And so I do have them on the blues. I mean, come on, let's be real. But even here, like, could you believe that my Markswoman doesn't have as many extra sculptures as my epics? And why is that? That is because during the exchange event of commander sculptures, these guys cannot be exchanged while these guys can. And so you should always use those first. Don't be saving those up. Use them, because hoarding and piling up on extra commander sculptures is not that big of a deal. You'll be able to exchange them at some point in time. But those epic generic commander sculptures won't have any use once you max out your epics. And so now the combination is between the luck you get getting commanders from keys, the commander of the week that you decide to spend coins on. In my example, I spent over 100 coins on Yulji because I wanted to max them quicker. And of course, the epic commander sculptures that you get. And so let's talk about a few commanders you should keep an eye on. The first one is none other than Pelagius. Pelagius is one of those commanders that fits everywhere as a commander for cavalry. He can be a leader, he can be a secondary, he can be paired with any legendary or any epic. He is pretty much everything you need for a cavalry commander that'll do a good amount of damage, not that much, but a good amount of damage. On top of that, he'll do nice rage restore, super important. I'll explain why in a moment. His passive skill is attack and defense of cavalry, which expertise goes up to 15%, and if not expertise, it is 10%. The garrison is whatever, and healing factor of 450, a 10% chance on every normal attack to heal. If you're in a big fight, a long fight, the likelihood of you healing a couple of times is very real, and so he can really help you out, keep those cavalries going. Not the craziest thing, right? Because cavalries are very, very, very squishy. So bigger, longer fights don't happen. And so the 10% is very, very, very rough. But still, there is some healing factor, which is really cool. Small FYI, his counterparts in the game are Eulgi for infantry, who does pretty much the same. He does, instead of healing, more damage bonus. He does, instead of a rage restore, defense reduction. But his expertise does pretty much the same for the infantries, which is infantry attack and defense going up to 15%. And the same can be said about Kusunoki, whose expertise does pretty much the same. And so there are counterparts to commanders within the game, but out of these three commanders, Pelagius is the one that stands out the most. Primarily because he's a cavalry and skill commander, setting him up correctly will give you huge amount of rage restore through rejuvenate, burning blood, and undying fury. You could even go for as far as this to get yourself in case you have him some for some reason on your garrison, which you shouldn't have him, but if you do and you get attacked, you can get more rage from here. And so by doing this, that, and this plus 100 rage factor, you can put him as a leading commander with a Minamoto in the back and get that Minamoto to cast consistently. So that's one of the reasons I like Pelagius. I think this is someone that you should keep an eye on. And use your epic commander sculptures as they come to slowly level him up. Getting him to that 5-5 early on is crucial to get that 10%. That's really the best thing you can do. Once you hit that 5-5, you're welcome to unlock him to a 5-5-1-1. Start working on the rest of the skills. Hope you fall on the healing more than you go on the garrison. And then you get your extra 5% at expertise. If there's another commander that I think is much, much more worth focusing on expertise, not focusing on leveling up, there are two focuses on here. Focusing on Pelagius for leveling levels and for his skills is okay, but him at a higher level is better than him expertise, because you can use him for much more. And of course the expertise helps. But in the case of Sun Tzu, expertising him as soon as you can will give you much better results than a Pelagius. Why is that? While Sun Tzu is an infantry commander, and so you all have less march speed, but you'll be more tanky. The beauty of Sun Tzu being an expertise commander is that the enhancement of the first skill is not only to damage factor or to extra buffs. It is also to the maximum targets his AoE can hit. That is right. Sun Tzu is a commander that has, as the first skill, area of effect skills, which means in a fan shape, anyone in that area up to 3 targets gets hit. And on top of all that, 50 rage regen per march you hit. So you can get up to 150 regen. Now, here's the key. Expertising him doesn't only almost double his damage factor. It also adds an extra additional damage of about 50, so that's 33% increase. And on top of all that, it almost doubles the amount of maximum targets from 3 to 5, and now you're gaining 250 rage. Can you imagine a Sun Tzu, an expertise Sun Tzu on the Arc of Osiris, when all that madness is going on and he's just casting, hitting 5 at a time. He's a skill commander too. Put him at the lead, give him rejuvenate, give him burning blood, and in the infantry side, you give him undying fury. give up a little bit of the... I could honestly still get there quite comfortably without giving up anything. Forget about this build, by the way. This is from before the update. He was... I maxed out the garrison because he was on my wall. He'll still be on my wall, but not with that build. Anyway, he is fantastic to expertise. As a matter of fact, I would suggest you expertise in him first so you can enjoy the AoE from very early on. That AoE will come very handy during barbarians as well. If you manage to AoE a barbarian in, that's a free barbarian kill without spending AP. You're gonna learn how to use AoE better by using Sun Tzu while hunting barbarians, and so you'll slowly understand the mechanic of barbarians and of how to get marches to follow you. Because even on a 1v1 situation or on a battlefield situation, when someone is fighting you and you retreat, they follow you. So you can learn how to make your enemies come into certain positions where your AoE will be better. And so having him expertised early on will give you huge advantage understanding AoE. Plus the fact that he's a great commander to pair with any other infantry commander, just like Pelagius, to round up a good, well done infantry march. Just like Pelagius, we get a little bit of passive skill that gives you an extra oomph. But in here, it's increased the troop damage, overall troop damage reduction by 10%, and increased infantry's health by 10%. This is why, for example, Iulgi was someone I looked at first. Because in my opinion, I was like, listen, I want the attack, I want the defense. I didn't realize that the AoE might have much better reward than having a little bit more attack. But really, I don't really use that attack that much. What am I attacking on the day-to-day? Primarily barbarians. On Ark of Osiris, he can do just as much damage. And so, I made that mistake. I think you should focus on Sun Tzu a little bit more. And you can pair your Sun Tzu with my next recommendation, Boudicca. That is right. We've always recommended Britain first, Boudicca commander, good, good, good. But now let's talk about why. Boudicca is one of those well-rounded commanders that once you have her expertised, she gains that additional damage factor that puts her over at the 1000 level, putting her at a competitive level on a battlefield. But the thing about her is, she is a very strong peacekeeping commander, 25% extra damage plus 20% extra XP gained once that's a level 5. And if you start as Britain, you can get to a 5-5 very, very quickly. And so from there, you can obviously go another step to go for the Rage Restore, which he's fantastic with. Remember, she's also a skill commander and a little bit of health. Health, healing, hello, why not? Of course. So a 5-5-5 Boudicca is actually really, really strong. I'm not a big fan of her fourth skill. 5% chance, 3% chance, 2% chance on extra damage. Too little percentages for me to care. But to get it to a point where she's well-rounded and she can compete on the battlefield, you're gonna have to expertise her because 600 damage factor is not enough. Even though the best thing out of it, and this is the most important out of it, to the target, you do 600 damage factor and you reduce its rage by 100. You also decrease the attack of the target's troops for the next 2 seconds. Her first skill is so nuts that you're actually gonna slow down your enemies from active skills by reducing their rage. And on top of that, you're gonna decrease those troops' attack for 2 seconds, for 2 full rounds. She is a fantastic commander to start with. She's a fantastic commander to get to a 5-5-5 as fast as you can. I would say 5-5 to say the least. And you should be leading with her and getting your Pelagius and your Sun Tzu to that level 60. That's why they are 6 stars, because my friends Lohar and Boudicca have been training them very hard. Now you guys can see I don't grind as much. I'm not that big of a grinder on Rise of Kingdoms. And so these guys are not level 60 yet. But if you do your basic barbarian hunting plus do good amounts of Lohars to max out your Lohar, you're going to see how much XP you gain really, really quickly using Boudicca at the front. One last epic commander I want to point out for you guys is Herman. Herman is one of those very undervalued commanders. The reason for that, there are not that many archer commanders out there. Archers are very, very, very underappreciated at this point in time. And the game has been skewing towards cavalry for so long that people are countering it with infantry and not caring about archers almost at all. But Herman It's actually a little bit of a sneaky guy, and I'll tell you why. His first skill gives you not only a nice damage factor, which once expertise, it's a very competitive damage factor. 750 is okay, 1150 is competitive. The most important thing in here is not even the damage though. This guy, from the beginning, from 5111, does an astonishing decrease of target's rage by 10 by 100. Just like Boudica, you're making sure your enemy doesn't proc as much. And on top of that, you silence them for 2 seconds. You guys have seen JWM themselves during KVK using this guy to silence the buildings that had AoE damage and destroy those buildings, because those buildings would never, never have their skills proccing because Boudica and Herman, multiple marches all over the place, were just destroying the opposition's rage and silencing them. Now, on top of that, you can use him for Karak. In Karak, there is a crazy set of bosses that do massive amounts of damage, and then when they kill you, they heal and stuff like that. You don't need to worry about that if every single individual has a Herman nearby. Or at least a few Hermans hitting the march, right? Not that many people are gonna bring a Herman in, but if you get at least a nice little 5, 6, 7 Hermans going consistently, active skill, nobody's ever gonna proc anything. No casts are gonna get done. And so Herman is one of those commanders that I would, in your position, at least get to this as soon as possible. Use your epic commander sculptures to get him here as soon as possible. On his second skill, he's already super useful for archers, extra attack, and march speed. Might be worth it for you to make it that 5-5 trip quick as well. And then you should probably skip 5-ing this. You can go insta to 5-5-1-1. And reaching normal attack damage bonus of 10% plus trigger chance, an additional chance to get rage, is interesting. But again, I think that his primary use is more for his first skill, which is better rounded with more damage when you expertise him. And so I would definitely aim at a 5 as soon as possible. Potentially round up quicker these with a little bit of commander, with the epic commander sculptures to add on to the little bits that you're missing to get that next level. And then work your way through these, because honestly, the trigger is nice, but 10% is not worth it. And I would definitely level him up to a point where he's at least level 40, 45. You can then use him for plenty, plenty of things, including potentially having leading troops. Again, if you want him as a leading commander, you're gonna want to level him up more. And so for today's video, we talked about leveling and expertising 4 major epic commanders. We're talking about Pelagius, Sun Tzu, Boudica, and Herman. Each and every one of them has a different utility. Each and every one of them you should prioritize differently. Pelagius being someone you should level up as much as you can to have him potentially leading your cavalry marches. You want to also get him as fast as you can towards the expertise, but you don't want to go too crazy. If you have to choose between him or Sun Tzu for expertising, I would go Sun Tzu first. We talked about why is that, because more targets can get hit, more additional rage per cast. Fantastic, 10 out of 10 for that. From there, Boudica is a fantastic commander to at least get to a 5-5-5 situation as soon as you can. I would even say that having a split between these two guys, meaning you're going to use your epic commanders to round up that next level. You have 20 of her and you need 25 for the next level, you're going to give those extra 5 and get that extra level. These two guys are very good for that. This is where you really want to focus most of your energy. And then from there, Herman to get to this 5 can make you very beneficial for your alliance as well as for yourself. You're going to decrease a lot of active skills and active damage coming at you with him. A few honorable mentions to keep in mind are someone like Joan. Joan is someone fantastic that very early on can give you an insane amount of buffs, gathering speed, and she's a very decent healer. With normal troops have 10% chance and effect can only be triggered once every 5 seconds. Not the craziest healer, but she is. And normal attack damage is a thing with her. And her expertise will not only add you a little bit of rage per second, it also gives you an extra 2 seconds. So it pretty much didn't only make you gain what, 120 rage more, but now you're also, it's longer. The effect of your buffs are longer. And so if there's a fifth one I would keep my eye on is your Joan. Your Joan, you should be leveling her up for gathering. You should get to that level 39, 40 as quickly as you can with her so you can maximize her gathering efficiency. You can see right here, I have her as a gatherer primarily. And so having her at a level 40 was very important for me, and I made her a 5-5 very, very quickly. This is not a commander I would stick too much into. You'll gain a lot of her with time. Once you hit this level right here, she's pretty much good to go. And so I didn't really want to talk too much about her. She's a fifth one I would keep my eye on. This doesn't mean all the other epic commanders are useless. This doesn't mean that all the other epic commanders are not worth maxing up first or in other orders. We're gonna talk about much more commanders in future videos, much more of these epic commanders, different approaches to look at these commanders. My goal is for you guys to make the decision. I'm not here to give you the decision. I'm here to give you the information, and you pick which one you think fits better for your gameplay. I'm Gekko. I'm out of here. Thank you guys very much for watching this video. If you guys like it, make sure you slap a like on the video, and of course, subscribe to the channel, Gekko Gaming, brand new name, everything. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram in the description as well. The Discord group popping, almost 1,300 members, should be 1,300 plus by the time this video is up. So thank you guys for joining the Discord group. Again, link in the description down below, GekkoGaming.tv/Discord. I'll see you guys sooner rather than later. Have a great rest of your day, weekend, afternoon, whatever the heck time it is when you're watching this video. Take care. Peace.